Well, hello there. Welcome back to the Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 313. I'm gonna say, hopefully it's 313. I actually recorded this episode yesterday, but due to some technical difficulties, I couldn't get put out in time. But here we are, nice and present. No need to panic anymore. I've got myself a new mic set up, so you should be seeing a little arm here if you're watching via YouTube. If you're not, then I don't know what you're doing. Listen to the audio version. Head over there to YouTube now. Check it out. But I've got a new audio setup, so please be patient whilst I get the microphone where it needs to be. I've graduated from using your kind of basic plug and play model that you'd use, you know, when you're first getting started, a little basic £30 USB mic from Amazon I got ages ago. But I thought, like, you know, since I'm taking this stuff a little bit more seriously and I'm trying to put out a bit more content and make sure that I can up the levels during the whole lockdown period, I thought, why not invest in a bit of new gear just to kind of get me going? Because I don't know about you, but I tend to do that whenever, especially when I was young. I think that was one thing that I was actually grateful for about not having money when we were younger, because, you know, most people, especially from the end, you're poor as fuck and you don't really realize that until you go to school. That's when you start to realize that just where the level you kind of where you rank in terms of, like, the home income, you know, level. And but one thing I do like about growing up broke was that, growing up poor, not broke, I didn't have any money to begin with, but growing up poor, the good thing was that you never really got the best gear, so you always just made do with what was available, whether it was borrowing people's boots or trainers or whatever it may be, or, you know, you all chipped in on a mic or you stole one from school. There was never the right equipment. It was always just like, you know, hacking things that already worked and trying to make those work. Like, I remember when I was listening to grime, I'd have to plug in this little children's speak stereo Walkman thingy to the hi-fi, because the recorder thing on the hi-fi was broken, so then I could record that onto tapes, and I was slinging those tapes in school. It was a whole scheme. But the good thing that that did is that once I got older and I had the means to buy, you know, things for myself, I didn't believe the hype that went into that thing. So if someone told me this pair of shoes will make you run faster, because now I had the means and I was so used to wearing shitty things, I would immediately buy into all the marketing BS. But I guess that mind frame, like I said, that mind frame gave me the appreciation of buying new things for yourself, and also gave me the made me humble enough to accept whatever I had available at the time and make the best out of it. I'm not really a big person. I'm not really super into the whole idea behind, you know, not having the gear is going to hold you back. I don't really subscribe to that. I think if anything, you should be, I kind of ascribe it to the whole DJ model, right? When you grow up trying to learn how to mix on belt drive turntables that are horrendous to use with shitty needles, it's more often, no, more likely than not, if you can destroy on those pair of decks, then if someone gives you a pair of CDJs, right, you can absolutely murder the places. You're gonna find it completely easy to do so. I'm using that sort of mode. So anyway, here we are, new show, here we're going, and talking about new things and all that malarkey, I thought I'd give you a little bit of review of my shoes after, what is it, like 20 miles I've done in them so far. So I thought this is probably amp time. So what was it, what should we say, a couple of months back, maybe 2 months ago, was it 2 months ago or maybe a month ago, because I don't know, time is, there is no way of judging a coronavirus time, and it's all a bit muddled. Hold on, see if I can get the mic over here. Is that right? Yeah, maybe it's right over here. But sometime a couple of months ago, I decided to retire my old New Balances and get some new shoes. I've been needing them for a while anyway, so I decided to go for a pair of Hokas. I think they're called, pronounced Hoka One One, and I didn't know what model to go for, so I went online, did the whole conventional thing everyone does, scours the videos on YouTube, and then I inevitably ended up with this model, the Hoka One Rincon, as you can see here from the video. If you're not watching the video, I'll put a link in the show notes so you can check them out. So these are billed as the everyday shoe. I think the kind of shoe that you can wear for training and you can wear for race day. I just needed something with a bit more support in this sole, so that I could, you know, number one, it could take my weight, and number two, that I could wear week in, week out, because I find myself destroying the shoes I had previously in, you know, record time. I've probably gone through the tread on these quite a bit as well. Probably haven't done them to any much justice. I try and make sure that my tread is only disappearing towards the front. That means I'm running on pose, but you can see there's some scuffs down the side. I've got about 20 miles in these so far, as you can see there, right? So the shoulder, yeah, 20 miles them so far, and I've got to be honest, I like them, man. I was never the biggest fan of maximalist shoes like this with the thick sole. I kind of prescribed the whole CrossFit endurance model where you run with a shoe with a minimalist sole and you kind of run on the toes of your feet. You make sure the heel slap the bottom of your buttocks, that kind of routine, right, from Brian McKenzie. But I decided to, again, use these just because I already have the form. I think my form is where it should be in terms of how I'm striking. So I should be able to get away with wearing a maximalist shoe, but also have the added benefit of having something that isn't going to kill my feet. Because that's something I found. Because my feet aren't strong. I haven't really built up the muscles in it just yet. And I was previously, for the best part of it, 15 plus years, I was extremely flat footed. But due to a bit of training and some stuff that I've learned online and reading some books, I've kind of trained my feet muscles and now I've developed a bit of an arch over time, but it's still not where it needs to be. So really flat minimalist shoes end up hurting after about mile 5 mile 6. So if I had to intend to do anything crazy during this lockdown season, or just during the lockdown period, I'm training to run a 10k in about 4 weeks' time. I'm doing the Hal Higdon 10k program, so I thought the best way to do it is get myself a pair of new running shoes to kind of aid my training. And yeah, like I said, I really find them comfortable. I think the midsole obviously helps in terms of taking my weight and allowing me to run a bit more rigorously throughout the week. So I'm basically doing 6 days running with one day off. So it's nice to wear these sort of shoes. I would say the only thing that I don't like about them, what would I say, maybe the insole. I had to rip my insole out. I usually always take out the inside of my shoes anyway. I kind of feel that it gives you unnecessary sort of extra bump into the shoe. And maybe because I've got quite fat feet, I tend to kind of need to have as much room as I can on the upper. The upper over a while, when I first got them, was extremely tight. But now I've worn them, they've obviously stretched out to the size of my foot. That's been good. But I guess when you first get them, they're a little bit tight around here. I think you just got to wear them in and hopefully they should open up a bit. There's an annoying thing there with the little crease that I think is probably just a consequence of just your foot being inside it. And obviously over time, your foot, especially if you've got any bunions on the edge there, you're definitely going to get some sort of creasing. So I won't put too much negative spin on that one. And of course, they've got the heel tab, which is something that's really overlooked in newer running shoes. I'm not too sure why heel tabs are not in. Maybe it's because they designed the shoes so that you can put them on and off without using your hands. But I like the addition of a heel tab. I like that kind of security of knowing how to pull my foot in without having to fuck up the heel padding here by squeezing your foot in. I quite like that. So that's a really good addition. But yeah, I recommend you check them out if you're that way inclined. Like I said, I reckon they're about £90, I think, in the UK. I'm not sure how much they are in the US, maybe about $120. Hoka One One Rincon was it a French company, I think, that made skis. So I'm really set on them. I think I'll probably get a few more, maybe a couple more New Balances too, to add to the collection. But this is my everyday shoe that I'm running in at the moment. So yeah, I'm enjoying those ones. And if you want to check me out, I'm actually on Strava too, so you can add me on there. I'm not sure how do you do the Strava ad. If you just maybe search my name, you can find me. And see if I can find my profile. There should be like a little profile page you can add people in, right? I'm doing loads of runs on the old Strava app, so you should be able to see that. Let me go on my profile here. How can you find it? Find friends, view submission. You can't view your profile, can you? It doesn't let me view it, but if you can find me on there, definitely check it out. Can you see that there? Is it there? Boom. Or maybe I'll just get it up on the screen so you guys can see. But I'm on Strava, so definitely come and add me if you want to connect with your running stuff. I quite like the, do you use the feed? I don't really use the feed on the running app. Sometimes it can get a bit disconcerting seeing some people I follow on here, they get up at the dusk of dawn and run an hour a day and shit, which is fucking insane. But everyone's got their way of doing things. Let me see if I can log in here to the app and see if you can find me. If you get up on his profile, one more second. Boom, 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 boom. Okay, there we go. Yeah. So it should be up on there if you can see on the screen. That's my name, and I don't think it lets you show my actual profile URL or anything, but this is my profile on there. So definitely check me out if you want to see the stuff that I'm doing, where I'm running, all that malarkey. I'm on the old Strava app. There you go. So let's move on. What's next here? I just hook up. This mic stand is not the best, actually. And that's what you get for spending 20 quid on a mic stand on Amazon. Anyway, let's see. Hopefully that helps. It doesn't move around too much. You can still hear me. So, some things I've seen on the internet that I thought would be of interest. Number one. this really cool video actually from Johnny Ive speaking.
And I sense I'm in excellent company.
Speaking during a Zoom phone call, I think, with some students. Took that off the screen, so if you couldn't hear that super loud, and I should prepare this beforehand, but hey. So I think Johnny Ive gave a talk for a bunch of students during lockdown, which has been pretty cool, I think, for people outside of the, you know, instigate or educational institutions to be able to have access to people such as, you know, Johnny Ive and other legendary people in design. It's hard to find out when these things are actually happening. I guess you have to maybe be on social a lot more than I am. I tend to just post and kind of exit out and don't really browse my feed. But if you are online and you are checking those places, or you've, you know, followed the feed of certain schools, make sure you check out the events pages, because most of those events that they have, where they have panel discussions and workshops, they're now doing them all over Zoom. So it's a great way to kind of get involved, find out what's going on, and kind of get a gauge of what the professionals are talking about, you know, because there are some people who are a bit down in the dumps, who are a bit half glass empty and being really pessimistic about things. But there are some people who are also, maybe it's because of their privilege, whatever it may be, but they're a bit more optimistic about the future, and they're kind of giving you a bit of a framework, or in this case with Johnny Ive, they're giving you, they're setting a question or setting a theme or posing a question, right? Look, kind of a thought experiment, in terms of you just kind of figure out exactly what you want to do next and how you decide to react to this whole situation. And I think the word react is a really apt for this little clip that I'm going to play. Give me 1 second. Yep, get up on here on the screen. Boop, 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 boop. There we go. This is Johnny Ive.
And I sense I'm in excellent company in saying that I think one of my biggest struggles is trying to reconcile a number of discrete truths, and they are whole and substantial. So whether it is the truth of the quite breathtaking human suffering and hardship and all that is terribly anxious making and ghastly about that, and that is complete, but there is another truth. And that somehow this, that they seem irreconcilable. '90s, Apple was just a few weeks away from bankruptcy. I think we had a couple of weeks left of money in the bank. But there was that sense of, well, one of the dangers at that point in time, when you're dealing with crisis, very often, I think crisis can set a tone for how you think. Of course, it has a huge impact in how we feel, but it can set a tone and exercise certain muscles in terms of here is crisis and then here is my reaction. And in a way that you can abdicate, you know, your control and your determination to actually figure out what it is that you want to do that is beyond just a reaction.
Yeah. And that's
measures.
And of course, that's something that I definitely agree with. I think it can be difficult though. I'm really sympathetic to people who have, you know, who just haven't necessarily lived a life where they encountered much hardship. So when something like this happens, it can maybe set you off course and make you feel a bit down in the dumps, because you've never, generally haven't gone through anything as difficult as what we're going through now at the moment. But you can't help but feeling there is also just so much opportunity. It's such a great time to kind of assess where you're going, decide what you want to do and what person you want to be at the end of this, right? Or on the other side. I think that's what it should be, to just go back to resort to being exactly how you were and continue to pick up exactly what you're doing previously. It's just a complete waste of reflection time, I think, in my opinion anyway. It just doesn't make any sense, especially considering how awful this could be if it was, you know, this could be much worse, right? We could be under attack from a, you know, from another nation, or we could be all at war in some regard, right? This could be something that could be a bit more severe in terms of how it affects people. It could be a little bit more black and white, right? There could just be one strain that's just taking out everybody, right? Similar to when, you know, Cortez went over and visited the Mexicans, isn't it, right? And just completely wiped them out. It could be similar to that, but it's not. It's something that we can contain. It's something that you can sort of like dance around, you can avoid. So why not take the opportunity whilst everyone is relaxing, not relaxed at work. Why is everyone then sort of like not at work and not outside, and this imposed lockdown to maybe improve yourself and to maybe kind of do those projects that you ever you always wanted to do, try something out, because why not? There is no risk related nowadays. You could always try something, and if it doesn't go well, people forget it by the time lockdown's over anyway. So I thought those were some really encouraging words from Johnny Ive. Again, I'm a big fan of his, of course. And I think nowadays, especially with the kids in university, man, it's such an amazing time, especially being indoors, having access or having the ability to watch multiple, you know, Zoom calls and streams of different professors and course directors talking about how to attack this thing, especially when it comes from people who actually work part of a company, right, who are practitioners, had some skin in the game, and aren't just talking from like a theoretical point of view. I think that's really, really, it's a valuable resource to use, so don't, do not ignore that at all if you can. So let's move on to some other ones I thought were cool. Dave Portnoy speaks about it as well from Barstool, but move on from that one. Project Restart, this is a good one. So the Premier League are considering restarting, right, the sometime I think between June and July. I think the government is sort of giving them a soft go ahead. You hear loads of reports that some people in the government are saying that, oh, if we get things started back up again in football, it's going to raise the sentiment of the nation. People are going to have a bit more feel-good factor around, which is, you know, a little bit, it's a little bit infantile and, you know, just naive to think that people will forget about the pain and the hardship they've gone through just because someone's kicking the ball into a net. I love football as much as anybody, but I'm not under any illusion that people are really suffering out there, and football, if anything, is just going to further remind them of just how fucked up their life is, right, and just how different it's going to be for, you know, for the foreseeable future. I think if anything, you want to, if you want to raise people's spirits and get the morale up, you know, you invent a vaccine ASAP, or you get more, you roll out testing quicker to more people in disadvantaged areas. That'll probably get people's morale up. But regardless, the government are floating this idea out there, and it seems like all the Premier League clubs are pushing for the Premier League to restart. Now, if you look into the details, you'll find out there's a lot of money on the line due to the TV rights, something close to 1 billion, if not just under. I've heard 700 million floated around, 800, but whatever it is, it's a lot of zeros. And the Premier League doesn't want to be in a position where they're having to pay back any money or being penalised or being taken to court. They don't want that noise, or they don't want that smoke. And a lot of the Premier League clubs, even though they get a lot of money through sponsorships and brand deals, most of their revenue comes, especially if you're outside the top six, comes from the gate receipts, right? The ticket sales and anything else that you attach to that stadium. That's where you make your big, big, big bucks on. So a lot of those clubs want the football to come back too. But then it's an interesting position that some of the players in the lower leagues, the ones who probably don't have, who probably have a lot more autonomy in terms of where they take their careers, people maybe in the top 10, maybe just below that, have kind of voiced their concerns about coming back, you know? And the rationale, I think, behind them, I think we're going to read an article now from Troy Deeney, but the basic premise of their argument is, if it's not safe enough for fans to come in the stadium, why should players be expected to play? Which is a fair enough argument to make. I guess if you're Dana White, you're going to tell them to, you know, to get kicking the ball straight away, because, you know, you run the rule. But I guess the fact that they've got the PFA, they've got all these individual bodies, have to get approval from FIFA. Is it FIFA or UEFA? I don't think UEFA has a say, actually. It's just the Premier League that decide, or the FA decide, right? There's a lot of unions and associations representing players' interests who are kind of speaking up and making sure their voices are heard. Captains are playing a big role in it. It's getting a little bit tetchy, and you feel as if it's going to reach a point where we might effectively see football restarting, which I think they're going to do regardless. I wouldn't really want it to come back. I think you should just null and void the season, or do that whole simulated thing with the season where you just award Liverpool the title and sort out the rest via a computer. That might be a good way to go about things, but just restarting it for the sake of it doesn't make any sense. If you give them the title, you're annoying null and void the season. But Trey Deeney has something to say about it. Let's go to his article before I start rambling on. So this is from BBC News. It says here, Premier League project restart. Trey Deeney and Grant Hanley raise concerns. Watford captain Troy Deeney says he's not going to put his family at risk amid concerns that he's about the Premier League's plans to restart the season. The striker, 31, said he would not play if he felt like he was putting his family in health in jeopardy. His concerns were echoed by Norwich captain Grant Hanley, who said he would be worried about returning home to his pregnant partner. And that's something I've said a lot, I think, previously in my other episodes, about the fact that the longer this went on, the more people, the more the play, especially, well, football players mostly, and some people in Hollywood. There's got an article here from, I'll read to you later, about Matt Damon, who's now, I think, in Ireland because he was filming something, but he's got a lot of family out there, and he's now fell in love with the country, and he might move. And then the stories of Chris Hemsworth lives in Australia with his family. He gets to avoid all the Hollywood paparazzi and gets to raise his kids in a semi-normal environment. I think for people, you know, you have much sympathy for them, but I think for a lot of entertainers and athletes, spending this time away from their sport, whilst they're probably still getting paid quite handsome anyway from their sponsors and doing maybe some Instagram postings here and there, they're probably realizing that, you know, the amount of training and stress they go through probably isn't as worth it as they thought it was. And their priorities change, right? Spending time at home with your family, reconnecting. Maybe, you know, some players have that thing where they've legitimately haven't seen their newborn child in maybe a couple of months. They get to connect with them. There's a different kind of bond developing because they're seeing them at home all the time. It's definitely going to change a lot of players' perspective, because I think, you know, even everyday people, you know, everyday folk are going to look at the situation we're going through. And they're going to be like, you know what, do I want to work in the job that I'm doing now? Do I want to keep pursuing this career? Or do I want to make a bit of a shift, a change? It's no different to a football player. They're also going to do the same thing. And I think the fact that the league weren't in communication with the players on a regular basis, that kind of gap in time gave those players a lot of time to think. And now they're thinking and they're really trying to assess it. They obviously come to a point where they're like, you know what, this doesn't make any sense. Why are we expected to go back to work under these conditions, especially in England, right? We've got some of the second highest death rate, I think, in the world. And look how small our country is. So if you're a Premier League player, you're worrying your rights to raise those concerns up and even question the fact that, you know, we're going out to, I think he might mention it here in an article, but, you know, the idea that you're going out to be at smash on pots and pans, do clap, you know, clap for the NHS at 8 p.m, but then you're allowing Premier League players to play, you know, for two matches a week, and then using up the, you know, medical resources that are needed to, you know, to give to regular civilians. That's not necessarily something that's going to sit well with a lot of players who have charities, maybe giving money to hospitals and stuff. They're not going to think, it's not going to be a good look for them regardless. Let's continue with the article here. It says both players were involved in the talks with the Premier League this week. A conference call took place on Wednesday between the players and the league medical staff and the Professional Football Association to discuss Project Restart. On the Thursday, the government said it was opening the door for the return of professional football in June. The Premier League hopes that it will return to action on the 12th, on the 12th of June, with matches played behind closed doors. It says here, it continues, I said, I'm not even talking about football at the moment. I'm talking about my family's health, Dini said on Instagram. I feel that I'm not looking after my family, that I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to put my family at risk. What are they going to do? Take money off me? I've been broke before, so it doesn't bother me. That's a really great line, actually, isn't it? Because I guess there's maybe the threat of the Premier League penalising him because he refused to turn up, or maybe his club doing the same thing, because, you know, maybe it's just in the rules. They're going to have to just penalise players that don't decide to go to training. But there are these are extenuating circumstances. I'm sure he could argue with his lawyer or with his representatives that, you know, they haven't necessarily created a safe environment for him to go back to. And especially, I'd imagine, if you've got a newborn kid, the last thing you want to do is to put a newborn baby who's just come into the world at risk by deciding to go kick a ball in there. It just isn't that important. Again, maybe because the UFC has restarted, it's putting pressure on some of these sporting leagues to look at ways to get things going again. I don't know. Maybe it's the sponsors that are pushing it, but it doesn't seem like there's a point to get that, especially if, like, you know, if there's things that are going to get lifted out of lockdown, you would expect football to be one of the last things, right? Considering the amount of variables, you want as little variables as possible to open up first so that you can kind of stem the tide, I would imagine, right? Because if you just open the floodgates and said everyone go back to normal, you would inevitably have loads of people going to hospital at the same time, right? I'd imagine that's why. So I don't necessarily see why they couldn't just cancel it now so that people could get prepared and mentally ready for the next season. It just doesn't make that much sense. And, you know, do players, I know players have been sitting on their bum or, you know, for a couple of weeks, but do players really want to go to playing from not doing anything and then go to playing two times in a week for what, like 2 months? Is that what is necessary to complete the league? It's a bit much. It continues. It said, they're talking about not playing in front of fans until 2021. if it's not safe enough for fans in the middle of a stadium, why would it be safe for players to be there? The Premier League has been suspended since the 13th of March. It's a really fair question, actually, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, and most teams have 9 fixtures left to play. Deeney said Watford were outside of relegation zone on goal difference when the season was halted. Hanley Norwich, bottom of the table, 6 points for positional safety. Other players, including defender Danny Rose and Man City Sergio Aguero and Raheem Sterling, have also previously raised their concerns about it, which is good, because I think once you get these players from all different, you know, from all different clubs who are sit in different positions in the Premier League, it gives their reason and their rationale more credence. People are going to listen to it more. If it was just like the top four clubs complaining or the clubs at the bottom, they'll just be like, oh, because you're going to get relegated because you've got too much money. But I guess because it's even spread of players across the league, I think they don't have any other opinion option but to listen. And if they don't, then I feel that the fans are going to take the side of the players, and they're going to, even though some of the fans will probably be gagging for football to come back so they could, you know, spend some time away from the family, which they have been, you know, handcuffed to these last few months or last couple of months. They're also under, you know, they would also be being more sympathetic to the players, because they just know it's not fair to be in an important position where you have no voice and you're required to play at your best level, you know, with 3 weeks training or something, with hoping you don't get an injury. Because that's what's really going to happen. Once everyone gets back, we're going to see a real spike in injuries. It continues here, says Culture Secretary Oliver Dowden said on Thursday that football will return if it's safe to do so, and the health and welfare of players and coaches comes first. It's such a non-comment though, isn't it, that? It's like me saying Christmas is going to come again. Just wait for it. It's like, it's a non-comment. It doesn't say anything about the dates or what kind of health procedures they're going to put in place. Nothing. Just it's going to come back. Like, okay, cool. He added here, I think the overall feeling in the players have got concerns, says defender Hanley. There's just so much uncertainty. He says here, the 28-year-old says the following. My missus is pregnant and she's due at the start of July. So it's obviously worries there for myself. Every team and players have got their different views on it. Some lads have obviously got vulnerable family members or whatever. Oh, true. I didn't think about that as well. It's just so difficult to see 5 or 6 days in front of us or anything past that. Ultimately, it's putting our family at risk that is the main concern. And that's the worry I think a lot of teams will have at this minute in time. Which kind of goes back to this, you know, I think everyone's kind of realizing that it looks like the easy option was to lock things down, right? That was a thing that everyone did in unison across the world, and because there was an easy choice to make, there wasn't anything else to do. No one really knew how to attack things. But now we've got more information, it appears like the actual the people who the separation between who's doing it things right or wrong is how they react in terms of opening up and what they do. That's where the actual creativity, ingenuity, foresight, and just maybe a strategy or, you know, whatever that may be comes into play. That's where you really earn your bucks. Like, how do you open things up? Because eventually things will have to open up, innit? We can't be indoors forever. Companies can't survive, you know, off the back of delivering Uber Eats. They're going to have to go back to normal some way, shape or form. It's just how do you do it and how soon? That's the real marker of if you actually know what you're doing. And for the most part, most of these governments, most of these governors, most of these MPs, mayors and stuff and politicians don't have a fucking clue. They don't know. They've never actually dealt with any kind of crisis, which is kind of concerning, isn't it? Because you'd imagine, you know, one of the main remits, one of the main stipulation or requirements for somebody that's working in office would be how you deal with that, how you respond under pressure, right? What creative ways can you come around and kind of fix an issue, fix a problem? And if you can't do that, then why do we need you? Because everyone knows how to celebrate good times. We all know how to put a parade on, a street party, right? The actual real moneymaker is, can you get your constituents out of this slump? Can you pull them out from beneath and make things right again? And most politicians are proving that they cannot really, you know, they're all struggling like fuck, man. Like my hair is at the moment. My hair is struggling. Oh, God. But what can you do? Let's move on. People in New Zealand are celebrating, it seems like, as well. Good luck to them. We'll play that one. I thought this guy was pretty funny. This dude from Maine, Wisconsin, decided to reject the lockdown rules and decided to reopen his bar because he felt as if, like, I think they've done 6 weeks of lockdown. They tried to stem the tide a bit, but I think because it's approaching tourist season, he just can't see a place and time where he can afford to have his bar or restaurant, whatever it is, completely closed during that entire time, which is, again, I have sympathy for. I think in the beginning, especially with those protests, you know, because most of those protests were people in the streets and shit, shouting in front of, you know, town halls. They usually contain, you know, some of the people on the lunatic fringe or whatever side of the argument they fall on. The people that want to stay in forever and the people that want to go out instantly now with no clothes on, they're, you know, equally as crazy. But I think those protest videos don't really represent, don't they don't articulate their point well enough in terms of, like, why are they protesting the nationwide lockdown? But I think some of these people that own their businesses and want to reopen again, like the woman that had a hair salon that got arrested, they've articulated it really well. Like, you know, like, we're willing to take the risk. We don't mind opening up at 20, 30, 40, 50% capacity, but they just want to be able to make some kind of living, and they don't think it's constitutionally correct for them to be, you know, denied the fact that denied the ability to make a living to support their family, put food in a plate, especially if you're in a position where you're told to close, and then you're told to close, and then you're told to close, and if you want to make money, if you want to get that money back that you've lost, go on benefits, you apply for benefits, because all that years you've been working, it probably is going to affect your benefits, and you won't get that much anyway, because they'll just see from your tax returns that you've had a business that's been grossing an X amount. So it puts you into this weird loop where you're essentially just handcuffed to the government, and they're having to decide when they can allow you to go back to making money to feed your family, which is incredibly nuts. But I thought his interview was really funny. I'll get up on a clip to show you. It's from YouTube. I think his name is Guy something, however.
Because the number of COVID-19 cases differs so wildly from county to county, the governor's plan to reopen businesses gradually on a statewide basis is coming up again.
One such business, a restaurant, opened a full month before it is supposed to, and it drew a crowd. Newsletter Maine's Hannah Dineen reports from Bethel.
We just defied the governor's order and we opened up.
Owner Rick Savage has opened the doors of Sunday River Brewing Company.
And of course his name is Rick Savage, and of course he has had sunglasses on his head, of course.
We were told May 1st, and we got ready for that, and last week, right before, you know, the beginning of the week, she changed it, and we just said we can't do it. People need to be opened up.
Restaurants are part of the second wave of the governor's plan to slowly reopen the state, which means this restaurant should not be open until June 1st. In spite of that order, these
I love the accent. Wisconsin, open up. It's sort of like a weird Canadian sort of vibe in it. Wisconsin, open up. But look at the queue. So they're all queuing outside of his restaurant, you know, in the rain, which is quite encouraging to see. Once everything does open up, there is this assumption that no one's going to be eating out anymore. Restaurants are going to, you know, die a slow death, which they probably are. But I think if you can survive and hang on to their life, I think the your local community or power or punters in general will want to see you win. So you're going to see a lot of kind of goodwill towards restaurants, people just booking, you know, seats to sit at their local or sit somewhere that they've always wanted to sit and grab a meal with their friends, whatever it may be, just to support them and make sure that they can survive another 2, 4, 6, you know, 8 months. So that's pretty cool to see. Like, they're all queuing in the rain right here to see this restaurant.
People, most of them not wearing face masks, came from across the state and beyond to express their support.
You can't keep people cooped up. This is America. We need to be free.
What is there to be afraid of? I don't fear the flu. I don't want to get it. I don't want to get this. But no, we've had it. Enough is enough.
It's unclear.
And even though it's, you know, it shouldn't be a political issue, it has turned into it across the world. You know, politicians are essentially fighting for the right to not be painted as some sort of, you know, coronavirus serial killer. No one wants to have that kind of blip on their CV. No one wants to be remembered as a person that essentially, you know, was essentially in charge when, you know, people's grannies and granddads were dying. No one wants that. But I find it interesting, observing from the outside in America especially, or outside in looking at America, that most of the people that are for the opening up of the states and people going back to normal are, you know, it seems like, especially from the media, they are predominantly, you know, Republicans, and they lean towards supporting Trump at all costs. Like, you just look at this video and the amount of red hats in this queue is just obscene, right? Everyone's sort of like MAGA and Trump in, And they're also very much against wearing a face mask, which I don't really understand. I think if you were going to be campaigning and championing for things to go back to normal, right, so you could go back to drinking your beers with your friends, shooting dice, playing pool, going to watch the football, whatever you do, right, wouldn't you want to get it done as quickly as possible? That would mean by making sure no one around you gets sick, or by at least trying to obey some sort of kind of like general rule to make sure the spread doesn't spread so quickly. Because you do the same if you got a cold, right? I don't know if people are the same, but if you had a flu or cold, you generally stay away from people. You wouldn't necessarily go to a crowded bar because, you know, you want to get everyone sick and they wouldn't want to sit around you as you're coughing and heaving on the table. So why is it any different to this? I guess because some of them probably don't even believe this exists, which is not a big majority. I think that whole conspiracy about it's not a real thing is sort of like falling by the wayside due to the sheer numbers around the world. It's hard to really, it's hard to kind of rationalize or even to yourself that there's some sort of malevolent force out there, you know, telling people to pretend that they're sick, you know, in this coordinated effort to bring down government and to sort of like, you know, have us living in this dictatorship or big brother state. That's not necessarily going to happen, but I just find it interesting. No one in this queue is wearing a mask, no one is observing social distancing, but they're ardently against being locked in their homes. It's like, well, you gotta, you know, meet us in the middle here.
Clear how or if law enforcement will react to the defiance of the governor's orders. As for Savage, he says he's prepared for fallout.
We feel she's going to arrest me today for violating the order, and frankly, we don't care.
In Bethel, Hannah Deneen.
Fair play to her, isn't it? Fair play to him, sorry. He's an absolute psychopath, but I like it, man. I like the approach. I'm interested to see what's going to happen next. It's disappointing that it's not the politicians who are, you know, being flexible and trying to see how they can reopen. It's going to be up to the civilians or up to regular folk to decide what happens next, because if one thing we've realized with governments is that, you know, they may be quick to enact something, but then when it comes to reversing it or sort of changing tact or, you know, kind of moving and being a little bit nimble, they move like a fucking, you know, they've got the turning circle of a fridge in that respect. No one really knows how to tackle this outside of just being in lockdown. It's sort of like, come on, make, you know, think of some other ideas, get more creative. You know, you essentially get paid to stand in front of a podium and do that weird finger thing. Like, give us something more. You know, what do I know? So let's move on here. What else we have on the list to talk about? Talk about celebrities moving away. This is an article from The Guardian. It says Matt Damon is enjoying his island retreat lockdown, which, again, like I said previously about the football thing, I think there's going to be a lot of entertainers, especially nowadays with social and with just, you know, the prevalence of streaming platforms. You don't necessarily need to go to LA and make it in Hollywood. It's not really a thing anymore. It shouldn't be. I think back in the days when there was a bit of a gated institution vibe where you essentially had to kind of pay your dues and kiss the ring and, you know, go to parties and, you know, do the whole air kissing thing, meet people, shake hands, whatever. But nowadays, if you want to actually make it in the industry, it sort of is to your benefit to sort of operate on the margin so that people come to you. So that when you get given a development deal or you get given a, you know, writing credits on something or opportunity to direct something, you can come into it with fresh eyes and you can also come into it on your terms. But I also think for people that are a bit more established, like people like Mike Damon, it's also an opportunity to maybe reassess where you actually are in the industry, because I'd imagine, you know, there's only so many of those sort of like, you know, filler movies you can do, or even some of the bigger projects you can do, until you get to a point where you're like, you know what, I've got a great body of work as an actor or, you know, as an entertainer, whatever it may be. I now want to concentrate on the things I actually enjoy. You're still going to get paid regardless, because you've reached a point, you know, where money's always going to be given to you just based on your legacy. But then it must get to a point where you're like, you know what, I now need to decide things that I want to actually get out of bed for. And I guess if you're Matt Damon, you've got the luxury to do that sort of thing, because he's, you know, been in the game for a while. But I like this comedy he made to The Guardian regarding his current lockdown experience in Ireland, and this might be a indication of what other people might do too. Regular civilians, I mean, you might decide to up sticks and go somewhere else too once this thing's over. But it's a headline. It says Matt Damon says his Ireland lockdown feels like a fairy tale. He says here the actor has been staying with his family in Dalkey, a seaside village on the south of Dublin since March after filming the island for The Last Duel, directed by Ridley Scott, was shut down. Local radio station Spin 1038 scooped Irish media by nabbing an interview that must have brought smiles to Ireland's tourism industry agency. He says the following. He says, it feels like a fairy tale. When I first came in, people were saying, well, Bono lives here, Enya lives here. It's been incredible. This is one of the most beautiful places we've ever been to. Obviously, what's going on in the world is horrible, but I've got my whole family. I'm with my kids. We have teachers with us because we were planning on missing school for about 8 weeks. We've got what nobody else has. Okay, we're just live human beings teaching our kids, so we feel a bit guilty. We've got this set up in the incredible place. It's absolutely gorgeous. Even in 2 kilometers lockdown, we've got trees, woods, and ocean. I can't think of any place you'd rather be for 2 kilometer radius, which is amazing, isn't it? But it's a great, what a great occurrence that he's, you know, that I guess because he's filming a movie, he decided to get that tutor in to sort of like help his kids out with their work. And then now because of lockdown, they have to stay there too. So he's got the ability to still be able to have his kids learn with an actual real teacher instead of on Zoom, which might be a bit gnarly. I wonder how kids are dealing with that, having to do their schoolwork on the computer, like legitimately, not just a couple of projects, like everything on there. I'm sure people built up intranets and, you know, sort of programs and websites that you can use. I'm sure they're probably sending the learning materials to certain, to families and people. Maybe, I wonder what they're doing for kids that, you know, from low income neighborhoods who probably don't have the funds to have a laptop. Hopefully they get tablets and shit. But I thought that was pretty cool to hear that Matt Damon decided to move over there, or to actually stay there whilst he was filming. Probably didn't have an option to come back, but maybe this is an indication that we might see a few more entertainers leave LA, leave California, leave the kind of coastal cities like New York, and decide to maybe, you know, set up shop somewhere in the middle of America, maybe somewhere like Texas, maybe somewhere like Wisconsin, that I mentioned earlier. Because, you know, if this isn't the time to reflect and make some change, when will it ever be? When will it ever be? So, move on here. What was on our list I thought was interesting? Oh, how will dance music change? This is from Ransom Note. It's a pretty lengthy article, but there's one bit in it that I want to read to you. So you're going to see a lot of these op-eds popping up, especially now that we know that we're probably going to head into about August, I say, until most things are reopened, right? In terms of hitting phase one and two, probably going to be about August, I'd say. So people are now coming to the realization, slowly but surely, that you're not going to probably see another festival in this conventional sense, or a nightclub in this conventional sense, up until next year. There's clubs will not be willing to take that risk of being liable for people, you know, falling ill, and let's say, you know, worst comes to worst, touch wood, someone ends up dying, no one wants that on their conscience at all. That's not a thing. So expect to see nightclubs and that stuff back again next year. So with that, it comes to you need to start thinking about how you're going to approach things and what your kind of goal is when you're going out, what your kind of idea is about how you put together a label, how to put together a party series, maybe how you promote yourself as an artist regardless, but just how everyone operates on the scene is going to be something that we're going to see a lot of changing, mostly because it's going to be enforced, they're going to be another option. I don't necessarily think a lot of people are going to do it out of the kindness of their hearts, right? I think someone mentioned it before in this article that we're going to see some bigger DJs doing tours in smaller markets and calling it a back to my roots thing, which is, you know, bit cynical, but we're going to see that happening. It's not going to be done for the kindness of heart. It's going to be done because they don't have any other gigs coming in. But I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing. I think it's going to be, we're going to reach a point where we're going to be working in unison a bit more and realizing that we all kind of add different pieces to one big pie. We're all kind of in the same thing together. We're operating different areas, different fan bases, but there's enough money, enough opportunities to go around. We just need to make a better way of kind of segmenting the audiences and the arenas so that there's no kind of unnecessary overlap, and so that allows each scene to build itself up in a really concrete and solid way, I would say anyway, because I don't believe in the idea of like saying, oh, this scene's bad, this one's good. Everything's got its benefits, just depends on where you fall. So this is from Ransom Note. It's titled Influencers, Fees and the Future: How Will Dance Music Change as a Result of the Pandemic? There's a question here at the end I thought was really interesting that I want to speak upon. Let's just scroll down the picture. So I think they interview about 4 or 5 people on here, and then, you know, each question they sort of answer it. But again, like I said, the question here at the end is one I wanted to talk about. It's a bit long, so I'll just quickly go through it. Boop, boop, boop. So it says here, what positive changes can you see the lockdown bring into nightclubs and DJ scene? And this is from, who answers this one? This is Johnny Wilkies. He says the following. Surely nobody wants to go back to being exactly the same. I hope not. Maybe there'll be a chance for individual city scenes to thrive because of the travel restrictions. That's part of youth culture that's always intrigued me, how details in the club music and art fashion can be very specific to a certain city. It's hard to predict any of this. I'm winging it, but whatever happens, I hope we see much less prospective club culture. Maybe we'll realise that when we're all together, when we're all gathered together to dance, what we have is precious, which I definitely agree with. I think that's one of the main, my kind of main bothers or annoyances when I went to Nicaragua for the first time, did a bit of travelling in Central America. And I remember that's one thing that bummed me out when I went to the local clubs there, hearing them banging, you know, every sort of like Drake track that we listen to here in the UK, they were kind of spinning that too at Nicaragua. And you would have liked them, I would have preferred to hear their local DJs playing music that they actually bang week in, week out, because I know that's not what they're listening to when they go back to their rooms or when they're outside, you know, talking in little circles, huddled up, dancing. I know that's what they're not listening to. Maybe again, back then, reggaeton wasn't as big as it is now, but I would have preferred to hear a bit stuff that was a bit more site specific. But again, maybe that because I was in the touristy area, you never know. But I hope going forward that we do see a lot more local scenes popping up. So if you do go to like a club in Dortmund, you see like a different vibe, feel than you would see if you went to somewhere like Stuttgart. That would be nice to see, right? Because I guess the reason why that happened because they had to cultivate a local scene because there was no way of getting people in and out, flying people in and out because of the restrictions on travel, and because, you know, some places might be a little bit tight in terms of how they allow people to travel for business and work and shit. That'd be good going forward. The next one is from Juan McLean, I've got you pronounce it. He says the following. He says, there's so much talk right now about other DJs, lots of finger pointing about who is in it for the right reasons or not. But I think this is just people spinning their wheels, anxiously sitting at home on social media all day. I actually have never met a DJ who I thought was in it for the wrong reasons, like strictly for money. Even top tier DJs who I'm friends with and who I know more than a few, they still love the music, playing for music. And as far as I can tell, for sure, many of them have lost touch with what it's like to struggle financially and embarked bit by bit on the lifestyle changes that make them appear like assholes, like flying in private jets or having absurd house hospitality riders, or just generally presenting a way of living on social media that's far out of reach for the rest of life, which I think is something that I think you could prescribe to everybody. I think we all went through a bit of a malaise. I'm not really for the whole like, hey man, the mother earth is kicking us in the ass and reminding us to like slow down, man. I'm not for that whole hippie shit, but there is something in that there was maybe a bit of a, we did maybe take things for granted. We thought we were invincible, right? We had that kind of like young man courage, where you kind of think the world is there to serve your needs. Nothing can ever conspire against you. You are immortal, you are undefeated. And then, you know, once you get a bit older, you end up getting a bit more cranky and a bit more realistic with things. But I think we did take things for granted. I don't think we appreciate what we had. And maybe this kind of enforced break will make us kind of realize, you know what, things are bad. Things are just not what they need to be. But all things considered, it's pretty sick. The fact that you got the ability to put on a night anywhere you want for the most part, get cheap equipment. You know, if you've got a good crew, a good community of artists you can kind of call and kind of get involved in with, you can kind of take part in scenes, you can travel for peanuts around Europe, maybe not in England. You know, the train fees are still a bit expensive, but there's things that you can do that are right at your fingertips that people should be doing more of, but they weren't. So maybe that would kind of, you know, spur people on. And I think for the bigger guys, yeah, there was a bit of, you know, there's a bit of phoning it in. You feel as if some of the top tier guys, especially, it feels like once you've hit like RA list, once you've got a couple tunes featured on Mixmag or DJ Mag, you've basically been set for life, right? If you get featured on Beatport and, you know, when your tune sells out and you're still making stuff and you're still touring actively and you don't mind, you know, the grueling schedules, you're basically set for life. You don't have to really do anything. You can just ride off the success of your one tune that dropped in 2008. And I guess for some of those top tier people, you know, you get to a point where, you know, 5 grand DJ gigs just turn into whatever. You just go there with your pre-made playlist and just play it from track 1 to 20 and just roll out, collect your check and keep it bouncing. So this probably might, you know, get them put a fire up their butt so that they go back into it and start appreciating just how high of a level they are. You never know. Maybe not. Maybe it does. It continues here. It says, I think that world will always exist. I've never really cared much about it. Me too, because it has not much of anything to do with me. I believe that the world will reemerge different, but the real positive changes I hope and believe will occur in the scenes I occupy. It will simply be a renewed appreciation for being in a club, what are other people, and having transformational experiences. I look forward to being a local resident again, which is awesome. Because we can't bring in our out-of-town DJs, who knows how long. The idea of playing regularly in the same space to essentially the same crowd with a regularity is exciting. For me, there will always be a huge emphasis on set preparation, making sure there's something new and fresh to present to people, and a massive consideration for experience of others. There will always be consideration for me before, but they seem vital now. Consequently, I think there will be an overwhelming feeling of gratitude and community from all of us from all of us meeting together on the dance floor. It is almost overwhelming to imagine what the vibe will be like for the first parties. I think we know what it's going to be like. It's just going to be an absolute horror show. People are going to be falling all over themselves. People are going to be yacked out of their minds, smashed out of their minds. It's not going to be pretty, the first couple of ones, right? First couple of weeks, and then it will get to a point where it will kind of even itself out again, which will be great to see. It'll be nice to see the return to maybe midweek parties, right, for the older folk or the more mature crowd who don't mind going, listen to someone play and just going home. Sort of like a gig, right? Because that used to be a thing back in the day. I'd say early 2000s, where you'd go to a club somewhere and see a live performance by someone that you like on a Wednesday or a Tuesday, get to hear them play for 4 to 5 hours, maybe have a couple of beers and just go home like a gig. But they stopped doing that sort of stuff, maybe because they were not getting the turnout they wanted, or the artists themselves, it was hard to kind of justify flying somebody in for a Monday, Tuesday gig. I don't know, but that would be pretty cool to see. But I don't envision it being, you know, Burning Man or anything, people being communal and helping each other out and, you know, making sure, well, they will be there helping each other out, but I don't think there'll be a lot of responsible drug taking or drinking. I don't think, if you think that's going to happen, then don't get your hopes up. People are going to go off the deep end just because they can, and, you know, you can't really blame them for doing so, actually. It continues here. What's this, Alinko? Skip that one. Posthuman says the following: I predict the winter of love. The scene that will replace this will be less dedicated by influential booking agencies and ticketing websites. These bubbles will burst. Techno Twitter will no doubt keep shouting, but DJs won't be playing. It'll open the doors for an entirely new generation, a lot more collaboration and cooperation, especially in the physical world of record shops and venues. I hope to be part of it, but I do not have any expectation of entitlement, which I like. It's a good sentiment. I think you're going to see a lot of that. There'll be maybe a renewed appreciation for record stores, people going out there and shopping again. I tend not to go to them anymore. I probably go only for their little in-store events when someone drops an EP or you go and see someone play. That's usually quite fun, but in terms of actually buying physical records, I don't, because I don't actually spin them. But there maybe is maybe I get to a point where I just buy records for the sake of it, just so I can support the artist, because, you know, downloading an album for like 99p versus buying a record, I'm assuming they're going to get a bigger percentage or slice out of the sale of a vinyl than they would do an mp3. That would be cool. And just generally having it in your collection, I think it's quite nice too, having like a separate vinyl collection that doesn't actively mirror your collection that you have on USB. That's a good option. But yeah, I'm interested to see how that goes and how that happens. Maybe we see new shops popping up with that kind of heart, because that was a concept that was really big in the UK, but a lot of them have kind of closed down over these. I'm not too sure why, because we do get a pretty decent turnout for these in-store events. Like when Fonica does those in-store events for DJs and artists when they drop an EP or whatever, or someone to do a little mix before they gig in the main club, there's a healthy amount of people that come out to them. It's not as if they're like empty. People turn out. So I wonder why there's not more of those spaces that kind of double up as a space where you can maybe live stream shows, like, you know, like on a radio station or whatever, and you can also do like, you know, signing events or whatever maybe. But who knows? But in the whole article is there for you to see. It's quite long. I won't read the whole thing. I'll put in the notes for you guys to check out yourself in the show notes descriptions. But it's titled "Influencers, Fees, and the Future: How Will Dance Music Change as a Result of the Pandemic?" It's on Ransom Note now, so check that out if you haven't already. Let's move on. Let's pray for Seth Truxler. This is funny. I guess off the back of the whole paying for my manager's life post that I was ripping the other day, I guess most of my frustration, anger came more so because, you know, I look up to Seth Troxel, someone that I kind of think is amazing, someone that maybe even kind of played a big role in getting me into DJing in the first place. And then on the other end of the scale, you've got someone like Carl Cox, who I've always thought was a bit of a wanker ever since he did that RA podcast interview back in the day and blamed the London riots on too many kids in the UK listening to fucking, what do you say, R&B or something. He's always seemed like a bit of a coconut, but that's by the by. But I think with the Seth thing, a lot of people in the scene were just disappointed in it because he speaks up really well for the scene. He advocates well for the community and people that are in it. And he just seems like a one of us in it. So for him to be so detached from reality, right, and to be so oblivious of how he's perceived, it just didn't make any sense. That video was just a whole lot of cringe. So I guess ever since then, any post he puts up on social, people immediately just post about, oh, how's your manager doing? Is he okay? And I guess this is a good example of it. This is one from the other day. He's kind of talking about some podcast that he was on. And if you go in the comments, it's like, look, the first one, how's your manager doing? And then one here again, are you going to ask people as well to donate money in order to read it like you did asking for us to support your tour managers instead of you and your fellow millionaire colleagues? People aren't really that mad, I think, again, mostly because of people at home. So I think if you're Seth and you're his mate, you probably need to tell him, look, don't take any of those comments too personally, right? People are just bored and they're at home. And you end up doing a thing that they don't like and they just want, you know, to kind of let off a bit of steam. But it's also a part of you, if you're Seth, where you're like thinking, hold on, if people are coming after me this hard, you know, based on something that minor, it's, don't get me wrong, it was a dickhead thing to do, but it, in the grand scheme of things, it's not that big of a deal. He should be asking himself, like, do people just not like me? Because that's generally a thing that happens, isn't it, with people in counseling culture or cancel culture, is that it usually happens. They usually turn the knife in or twist the knife in when it's somebody they don't like. So they look for any opportunity for you to kind of slip up, make a mistake, and as soon as you do, they pounce on it, and then they kind of want to hound you out and completely get rid of you because they never liked you to begin with. But then point 2.5 would be, like, if you're one of Seth Chocolate's friends, you have to tell him that, hey, the people commenting on the side aren't necessarily your fans, yeah, because you would like to think if Seth put on a show tomorrow at some venue that was handing out 50 people and he'd sell it out in seconds, right, he's still gonna, you know, draw in a lot of people to come see him play in clubs. So it's not as if, like, the majority of his fans are turned off to his music. There's people that was in the middle and probably not fans of his already that are the ones commenting or the ones that are getting most annoyed by the whole situation. But it continues here, says, can you donate to your fans? We supported you in the past. Now a lot of your fans lost a job. Are you going to help them? Which is wild. That's true, actually, isn't it? Like, there's no people, like, you know those festivals where, I think it's maybe Italy, right, where all the fans are, like, screaming and shouting and whistling and whatever it may be. Those are probably some of the best crowds to play to, right? Some places in Ireland, too, are like, I forgot what the festival is. Maybe the AVA festival, where it seems as if, like, the kids, the crowd is, like, you know, like they've all been mollied up, they've all been, you know, electrocuted, and they're just going for it. It's a real it's a real electric environment, let's say. You would think that there could be a rationale or reason for some partners to be like, hey, we supported you, we gave you one of your best clubbing experiences ever, you know, and they give you a screenshot of some post you put on Instagram stories, and I've lost my job and I was that guy in the front row. Why don't you support me now? Why don't you make a fundraiser for me so that I can, you know, continue living? Why don't you do that? And they're not. And instead, they're giving you these selfie videos of them telling you to make sure their tour manager's safe. It's like, oh, that's so tone deaf, man. He's going to have to regret that for a long time, man. Tour manager, fundraiser. Like, what? It continues here. It says, profiteer. It said, did you pay for your manager? Pay your manager. Pay your tour manager. Seriously, you are asking for money to young people in this period. I hope your video will become viral and show to all your fans and everyone your real face. Like, people are mad as hell. God almighty. Says, here, you're fucking tour manager. So how much did you exactly contribute to pay to your manager? It just keeps going on and on and on. It says, look, have you started OnlyFans account to support your tour manager? Give us a link. God almighty. But yeah, if ever there was a moment in this whole time during the whole lockdown for celebrities to just not be online and to not be putting their face front and center, now's the moment. This is where you have to practice a little bit of humility and just take yourself away from the conversation. No one wants to hear from anyone that's a celebrity or well-known figure. They don't want to hear it. They want you to just shut the fuck up and just enjoy your millions, because the moment they see your face, it's probably a reminder of just how affluent you are, or how well off you are, how, you know, far away they are from you. I don't know. That's probably a thing that they're thinking about. Jesus, man. I feel for Steph Troxler, to be honest. Hope it gets better for him soon online, but I'm sure he is not worried about it. What else we want to talk about before we end here? Before we go, what else did I want to say? Pray for Seth. Pray for everything. We'll talk about it another time. Boom. I think that might be it, you know. Yeah, that would probably end it there for now, just because an hour's up and I don't want to keep you guys too long. Maybe I'll casually end it with this one, because I went to get these. I'm not sure what you guys think of them. So these are the Stray Rats New Balances, right? They're meant to be dropping, I think, in about 6 days. I'm sure some of you guys have seen them already. This is maybe the second pair they've put out. I think they had put out a 990 V3 recently, but I really like this model. This is from Hypebeast. Put up on the screen. It says Stray Rats New Balance are ready to release a collaborative 827 shoe. I'm not sure if it's a new model or an old, but I haven't necessarily seen it featured previously before. But I think they're doing a lot of collaborations with it. Maybe it's a kind of shape that they want to promote and give a bit more love. But Stray Rats I've got an affinity with. I've known Coops from the forums, a founder of Stray Rats, for a while. I haven't spoken to him in a long time, but you know, and I was there from when the inception and when it kind of started. So to see them still going strong now, 10 years on, is fucking crazy, considering, you know, the stuff that he was doing in the beginning and how it's evolved in a really organic way. It sort of reminds me of like an extension of maybe Braindead or something. So operates in that sort of climate where they can do the basic merch things, but when he gets into his cut and sew fashion bag, he can also kind of, you know, compete with some of the best in the industry. And just generally, you know, you've got a bit more of a unique point of view and eclectic taste in how they kind of put things together. So this 827 is obviously done in a really cool way. You've got this combination, I'm gonna say, of suede, and it might look like corduroy. I'm not too sure what the ribbon here on the side, but I like the color combination. It's really beautiful. It's maybe like a play on camo, because you've got the camo print here on the heel tab. So you've got loads of nice greens, browns, pine greens, and of course the quintessential. A lot of people have been doing this. I'm not sure if this is probably a nod to like hiking boots, but a lot of shoes have been adopting like the bright red contrast lacing. You've got the No Vacancy Vans, so New Balances that I have, that have the same thing. You got a few other Air Forces that came out with red lace. I'm not too sure. There's been a lot of shoes lately that have had the, you know, that real bright red lace. And you've got, of course, that beautiful end there with the purple and the red outer. So they're due to come out soon. Let's read what Hypey said here. It says, Julian's New York based imprint Stray Rats and New Balance have teamed up with New Balance's team up on the 827, delivering a luxe take on the retro sneaker. This pair follows on from the Stray Rats Joker inspired 990, which I really liked actually. I'm not a fan of the 990 V3. I think the shape's a bit weird. That sole I'm not really a big fan of, but I like the actual color block application on the shoe and what they actually did with it. The theme behind it was pretty interesting, but I just don't like the sole. I think the sole looks a bit naff, in my opinion. That's just what I would say behind it. But this is probably my favorite here, this new 827. Go back, blah blah blah. This pair follows on from the Stray Rats Joker 990 Alternate 2 offering that released in last May and delivers a much more reserved colorway than previous collaboration. The 827 in question was previously teased by Julian and shows a dark hazel brown suede mesh upper alongside elements such as brown, green, and webbing. Oh, and there's a 3M as well, actually. Camouflage, okay, that's at the back. That's awesome to see. A khaki green absorb equipped sole unit sits off the upper and complements the camouflage moments found around the sneaker. Moments, you know, on sneakers, what are you talking about? But anyway, dates, most important thing, is the 15th, so sometime tomorrow. I'm assuming people are going to be able to buy them in the US. I think the UK is next week, and they're probably going to be open up for, yeah, next week is the UK. They should be available on Goodhood and whatever. But yeah, I'm a big fan of these. I like them. I think it's been a bit of a New Balance year anyway, maybe New Balance 18 months. It seems like all the best or most interesting collaborations have come from that camp. And I like the fact that they are trialing out newer shapes or newer models or older on the market models with brands that we know and love to kind of give them the attention that they need, and hoping a lot more kids kind of, you know, diversify their sneaker portfolio and buy these sort of things. But it seems like there is a real division between sneaker buying in it. You get a group of people who buy the quintessential Jordan 1s, Yeezy 350s, and that sort of malarkey. And then you get people who buy everything else, right? It doesn't seem there's anything in between. It's sort of like you buy the hype, trendy stuff that comes out because you've got like a little 16-year-old kid that kind of plugs you in and gives you good deals or gets them for you or queues up for you, whatever, who's got bots. And then you get the other guys who just buy the general stuff. And maybe there's people in between, actually. Yeah, there is. There's three. There's that group, hype beast kids. There's people like me that like to buy stuff that, you know, the hype beast I'm not going to be into just because I'm going to be able to pick it up, really. It's just, you know, it's just kind of a bit of a hipster buying decision there. And then you've got the kids in between who are like to wear that sort of, like, you know, those sort of like monochromatic outfits where they sort of stand weird and they have those beanies rolled up and they always wear brown, cream, gray, white. And if they've got a girlfriend, they end up looking exactly like each other, you know, wearing these fucking big, massive, bellowing, box-fitting shirts and weird crop trousers, and they all seem to be really short. Like, yeah, different groups, different people, everyone needs different brands, but I will be a big fan of these. I would definitely wear the fuck out of them if I get them, so I'm going to put myself on a list for them. Hopefully I win a raffle and I get a pair, and if not, I will cry into my sleep. But hey, what can you do? So that's the Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 313. Thanks again for tuning in. It's been a pleasure to have you here with me. Hopefully the audio didn't fuck up and it was nice and clear. I've got a new mic. I've spent a lot of money in it, so hopefully that did work. If you want more information about myself, please click the link below. There'll be in the show notes description. AgostinhoZinga.com for more information, social accounts, you know, emailing me, blogs, DJ mixes can be all on there. And I'll see you guys again tomorrow for an episode of the show. But until then, take care, be safe. Bye.